the brackets and bring you up to date on what's happened earlier here at the XL Energy Center. Number one, Centennial, they got by a big scare from Holy Angels, 2-0. Meanwhile, Wayzata had no problems with Tartan. They win by a score of 6-0. And Phil, you look at this matchup, I don't think there'll be a shutout in this matchup.
No, Moorhead, well, I don't know. Moorhead's going to win, I think. But Moorhead just got too much depth, and they're so well-balanced scoring. They're led by a senior, Brian Gifford, who's a Mr. Minnesota Hockey finalist. They have five guys that have scored 35 points or more. They have two guys on the blue line, John Ammerman and Brian Liu, who can lug the puck and score offensively from the back part. Their goaltending's exceptional, and plus their power play's at 40%, and that's unheard of for a state high school hockey tournament.
Well, Tommy, that doesn't sound like Elk River has much of a chance then here.
Well, I'll tell you what, the always animated Tony Sarsland has got his Elk River team ready to go. They're a hardworking physical team. In fact, their nickname should be the Big Bang, because they're going to come into the zone and they're going to hit everything in sight. Jersey on jersey is their motto, and we're looking forward to seeing them tonight.
All right, let's bring you now to our announcers who will call the action of tonight's game. Let's go upstairs with Lou Nanny and Wally Shaver. Gentlemen.
Thanks very much, guys, and we're certainly looking forward to this matchup. There are a couple of teams that have met for quite a few years in their respective sections and also here in tournament play. But Louie, we take a look at what has happened with Moorhead this year, and as Phil had pointed out, such a deep lineup. They've scored a ton of goals all season long, and that carried through into the playoffs as well.
Oh, in the regionals, they scored 42, outscoring the opponents 42-3. One game, they had 27. This is a machine. This is a team that's got balance. This is a team that could score from all lines and from the point, as Phil had pointed out earlier.
As far as Elk River is concerned, they're a team that's not quite as deep in talent as they have been for previous contests with Tony Sarsland behind the bench. He is very animated, gets in everybody's face down there, and he's got his players playing that kind of a style of hockey. They're going to be in your face. That's about the only way they can really beat Moorhead.
You know that when you're playing a Tony Sarsland team, you're going to be in a game. Believe me, Moorhead's going to know they're in a game tonight, because the only way that this Elk River team can win is they're going to have to be very physical, and especially in the forechecking zone. They will be coming after Moorhead, so Moorhead has to be ready tonight.
Scoring was absent for the losing teams in today's earlier matchups. Centennial winning by a shutout. They move on to semifinal Friday, as do the Wayzata Trojans, making their first appearance in the state tournament in 50 years. Stay tuned. Moorhead and Elk River next.
Fox 9's coverage of the Minnesota State High School League's Boys Hockey Championships is brought to you by U.S. Bank, home of the five-star service guarantee. Menards, save big money at Menards. Toyota and your Minnesota Toyota dealers. Don't go away. Fox 9's coverage of the Boys Hockey Championships will be right back.
The Moorhead Spuds suffered only two losses this year, one to Duluth East and another to Centennial. They won the Mariucci Conference, going a perfect 8-0. On the other side of the table, the Elk River Elks have suffered eight losses on the year, but they enter this tournament with 10 straight wins after winning the Northwest Suburban Conference with a 13-2-1 record. They are also 1-2 here at the XL Energy Center in the holiday tournament. And a good round of fans in both sides here to cheer on their respective teams tonight. Moorhead Spuds and the Elk River Elks. Love how those Moorhead fans get all dressed up. They got that blaze orange on, so whenever that camera goes down panning to the left side of our screen tonight, you're gonna see all those people down there. Let's take a look at what our game plan is for this one tonight. Moorhead, Louis, we've talked about the balance that this team possesses.
They got great balance, and they really have what you want to have in a hockey team, the ability to bring the puck out of their zone with speed. Two defensemen back there that can really skate and handle the puck, and they also have scoring from all three lines.
Tony Sarsland says he loves to have players come to the rink with gravel in their pants.
Well, he made some changes in the lineup late in the year. He kept some seniors that are bigger and stronger because he felt he had to have a physical team to get through the regionals, which he did do, and it's going to serve him well if they're going to win tonight, because they're going to have to try and slow Moorhead down.
All right, let's go downstairs and find out who these guys look like before they put all that gear back on. Downstairs for the umpteenth time with us this season, Dick Stanford.
Good evening once again, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Minnesota State High School Boys Hockey Tournament and to the XL Energy Center. Tonight's first quarterfinal matchup of the evening, matches the champions of Section 8AA with a record of 24-2-0, the Spuds from Moorhead. And the champions of Section 4AA with a record of 19-8-1, the Elk from Elk River. And now we begin our introductions by meeting the Moorhead cheerleaders. Say hello to Julia Lugin, Eden Frederick, Caroline Orozco, Allie Lobitz, Koyla Dickelman, Jimmy Rosenfeld, and the Moorhead Spud. And the team is coached by Alicia Severson. And now let's meet the players. First, the Moorhead Spuds. Senior defenseman number 2, Nate Connerin. Junior defenseman wearing number 3, Tyler Johnson. Junior defenseman number 4, John Ammerman. Junior defenseman number 6, Fred Barta. Senior defenseman number 7, Joe Emmerich. Senior wing number 8, Chris Henry. Junior wing number 10, Ryan Klukey. Senior wing number 11, Nick Dykes. Junior center number 12, Corey Johnson. Junior wing number 15, Matt Becker. Junior wing number 19, Corey Luce. Senior center number 21, Brian Gifford. Junior defense number 22, Brian Lee. Senior wing number 23, Nolan Oliver. Junior wing number 24, Nate Miller. Senior wing number 25, Jeff Holtz. Junior center number 26, Chris Vandevelde. Junior goaltender number 30, Derek Hiddle. Junior goaltender number 31, Spencer Deist. Moorhead head coach Dave Morinville and his assistants Terry Shercliffe and Rory Sandvig, the Moorhead Spuds. And before we move on, James Holtz, number 27, senior wing, and our apologies. And now let's meet the Elk River Area Elks. Say hello to senior defenseman number 2, Joe Malzahn. Senior forward number 3, Kurt Eccles. Junior defense number 6, Zach Shaheen. Junior forward number 7, Kyle Azahi. Senior forward number 8, Dustin Longley. Senior forward number 9, Dan Prody. Senior forward number 10, Joe Long. Junior forward number 11, Mitch Weber. Junior forward number 12, Colin Ostrud. Junior defenseman number 14, Matt Godlewski. senior defense, number 15, Kyle Rogers. Junior forward, number 16, Cole Scattarelli. Junior defense, number 17, Jake Kupka. Sophomore forward, number 18, Brad Peterson. Senior forward, number 19, Jeremy Zake. Senior goaltender, number 20, Aaron Baumgartner. Senior defense, number 21, Chris Johnson. Junior forward, number 29, Trent Graham. Junior goaltender, number 31, Sam Warhol. And junior forward, number 33, Shane Coro. Elks head coach Tony Sarsland and his assistants Paul Burning and Rob Luftus, the Elk River Elks. And now, ladies and gentlemen, that we ask you to please stand and honor America and our men and women in uniform for the playing of our national anthem.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Glad to have you with us here on the quarterfinals here on a Wednesday night. Thursday night. What night are we at here? It's just Thursday night. Wally Shaver and Lou Nanny with you as we decide two more teams to go on to the semifinals for tomorrow night. Our officials are Scott Parker and Pat Carroll, of veterans of the high school hockey, and the linesman tonight, Michael Elam. Center, number 21, Brian Gifford. The Elk River Elks coming in for the fourth time in the past 6 years to the state tournament. The Moorhead Spuds are in for their fourth straight year. And our car soup starting goalkeeper for the Spuds, wearing the dark tonight, is Derek Heidel. They've been splitting goaltenders all season long, but this guy comes in with some absolutely great numbers. As Phil Housley pointed out a little bit earlier, Heidel's numbers are 1.0 goals against average and a saves percentage of 93%. Those are both outstanding numbers at any level of hockey. At the other end of the building for the Elk River, it'll be Sam Warhol, who's been the number one goaltender of recent. 12-4 is his overall record. His number's a little bit worse. 2.35 goals against average and a saves percentage down around 87%. Louis, I'm sure a lot of people would like to see those numbers a little bit higher. But what the heck? Elk River's here in the show.
Well, and he's a very confident young man. Just before the regional started, he was having a real good practice. The end of practice, one of the coaches came over and said to Tony, "Boy, the kid looks good, doesn't he?" He says, "He certainly does." And Tony no sooner said that, the youngster skated up to him and said, "Mr. Sarsland," he said, "get on my back. I'm going to take you to the state tournament." And he certainly has done that. He's played very well, a confident goaltender. And he's going to have to be that tonight because he will get tested by Moorhead.
Michael Elam drops the puck. Immediately, Elk River taking control of it, but losing the biscuit at center ice. Grabbed up by Moorhead. Gifford as he goes back into his own zone with the pass. Out to center ice, it's relayed, broken up there by Johnson, number 21, for the white-clad Elk River Elks. Now Moorhead trying to get that vicious offense going. Here's Bites at center, launching a long shot off the end glass. In forward is Oliver, is a top line out there. A chance for Bites at the side of the net. Block, buckles off to the side and pushed ahead. And here comes Elk River making their first foray up across center ice. Ostroot shooting it in deep. Back for it is Connerin. Lost the pocket, played out in front, but picked off there by Johnson. And here comes Corey Johnson to center. Across the line, he has two on his right, trying to get it through. And the puck just goes off the stick of number 15, Matt Becker. Back in behind the goal. Elk River trying to get it. Godlewski going up the right side, throwing it out to center ice, but it's picked off there by Ammerman. This is one of the really good players Halsley was talking about early in the broadcast. Ammerman, a good, fine stick-handling defenseman back there for Moorhead. Becker playing it back along the boards, tied up in the skates of Corey Luce, number 19. Moorhead deciding to go with a change in the attack zone. It allows Elk River a chance to clear it out to center ice. Picked off there by Van de Velde, a Moorhead. He then turns it over. Now the Elks on the attack, trying to thread it through to a breaking number 7, Kyle Azzotti, but it doesn't go that way. Instead, back comes Van de Velde for Moorhead with a shot. Oh, and it's kicked out by the left leg. Now picked up by Kurt Eccles. Eccles can't get it out. Holding it in now is Lee. Lee, another one of those fine skating defensemen for Moorhead. Just plays it deep into the corner. Forechecking pressure being applied. One man in deep for Moorhead right now. Elk River will ring it around to the weak side for Mitch Weber. He's checked up along the boards, but spins away from Ryan Kluke, but does not clear it out. Shot back in behind the goal by Tyler Johnson. Picked up now by Izzotti. Banks it out to center ice. Moorhead back across the line, but stopped just inside the line. Elks getting it in. Godlewski, head man pass, bounces deep into the zone, and it will be icing as the Elks shot it from their side of center.
Good pace there, Wally, for 2.5 minutes. One thing you notice, even though neither team has blazing speed, Moorhead's a pretty good skating team. One thing they're going to do, and you'll notice them do, is constantly be in motion. That way they put a lot of pressure on Elk River. They want to make certain that they get Elk River to turn that puck over into the defensive zone, and they've been able to do that, had a couple of chances, and Warhol had to make two real good saves thus far.
Spudge back in their own zone with John Ammerman. He was on the National Select 16 team. Ammerman's pass going out across the line, but Gifford is checked across the line, carrying on. There's a drive towards the net, blocked by Warhol. Play back in the, at least attempted to go behind the goal. Finally, the Elks drive it off the glass. It will become icing as it goes down the distance and across the goal line.
Well, Rick, we've just noticed, you know, the one thing Moorhead does do, and they do very well, is they turn the puck up ice quickly. When they get control of that puck, they're moving, and they are not afraid to skate with it. They draw people to them, and they try and make the play. They are a team that's constant motion, and they've been able to make transitions in that neutral zone very, very sharply thus far in this game.
From center ice, the puck is driven in by Nate Connerin. Also a good soccer player. Playing it into the zone, but chasing it down now is Corey Johnson, playing it back to the point. And that shot deflects into the mesh up above the glass here at the XL Energy Center. There's a good look at that fine defenseman, Brian Lee.
He was one of two of them. There's Brian Lee, number 22, and Ammerman, number 4. Talking to the coach before the game, he was very proud that Moorhead's the only school in America that had two on the under 16 team, yeah, who played over in Europe and played extremely well. Two outstanding young defensemen that have been developed up in that area.
Moorhead intercepting a pass to try to get a 3-on-2 initiated. Lose the puck, but then send it in deep. Back go the Elks into their own zone. Kyle Rogers winging it around to number 14, Matt Godlewski. Back in behind the net, several players digging away. Godlewski circles in for it, heads off to the right. Out to center, angling left. Crossing the center checkered line and driving it in. Spuds back for it. Here they come out to center, a long pass, it's errant. Pistols are going to wave off the icing, feeling that Godlewski could have made a play on it. He's the best defenseman for Elk River, cranking it off the glass to center. Moorhead regained possession at their own line. Sparta lost it, puck hanging loose. Shot in by Moorhead, they were delayed offside, but they tag up. Play will continue. trying to get a steal. They throw some bodies out there, but Elk River has not had much of a chance to get things going in the attack zone. And here's why. Moorhead right back on the rush. John Ammerman leaving a trailing pass. Nobody there. Shane Coral moves it back out to neutral for Elk River. It's spinorama there by number six, Barta. Brett Barta, though, checked up along the boards, continues to pry away for it with the help of Vandevelde. They once more hand it in deep to the Elk River zone. Elks with time, bank at the center. Receive it back, straight up the middle now. Chris Johnson fires it in, gives chase. Johnson into the corner, hammered into the end wall, and a good jolt. Goes around to the other door, though, for Dustin Longley, but he loses the puck. Back the other direction comes Nolan Oliver. Oliver across the line to Dites. He goes into the corner, tried to circle there, but had the puck stripped off his stick. Elk River back to center.
Elk River doing a real good job supporting their defense, and forwards coming down deep to help out. They know they're going to be under pressure, and they've had real good help back there, not giving Moorhead much freedom to move that puck around down deep in the Elk River zone.
Godlewski, like a good defenseman, looking over both shoulders to check out where his teammates are and where the pressure is being applied. But he's stuck in the corner now. He's number 14. Coming in for the loose puck is Captain Dites. Dites, number 11, for the dark-clad Moorhead Spuds, digging away, trying to get it out of there. Does. Try to walk in front, but it's taken away by Joe Long. Longman is upended. There'll be a penalty coming to the Spuds. And the first power play of the game will go in favor of Elk River. It's a scoreless game so far, and Elk River looking for their first offense.
Corey Luce is hooking Joe Long right here, and Moorhead's going to have a shorthanded penalty right now as Elk River going to get the first power play opportunity of the evening between these two clubs.
They've scored 36 power play goals so far, and they have a conversion rate of 29.3%. They set it up. Pass down low by Ostroot. Team Dew on the power play. Ostroot, number 12, trying to play it down low, trying to get it back, but it's intercepted by the Spuds and cleared out by number 12, Corey Johnson. Here's the goalkeeper taking a look at things. It's Warhol backhanding it off the boards and flying into their own zone. Now it's Joe Long. Long across the line, going down to the left side, goes behind the net, tries to center it. Oh, it almost bounced off of Connor and into the net. Back behind the goal. Here's Ostroot. Ostroot working the wall, back to Long on the left side wall. Throws it back down low, at least attempted to, but it was blocked along the boards there by Vandevelde. And we're going to have a hand pass call against Elk River.
Elk River has really come to play tonight. They know they're facing a great team, and they are working hard. They have to work hard against Moorhead. They're supporting one another all the time along the wall. Just before the penalty, Wally, we're going to point out they had four men deep behind the goal line to make certain they got that puck out. And Moorhead, when they notice this, they're going to start moving that puck around, probably use the points a lot more, get some shots from way out there. But Elk River has been moving the puck well. They've been working hard. We've got ourselves a real good game here tonight.
And that's something we always don't see a lot of, is four guys down that low.
Not often, because if you make a mistake down there, you're going to give up a quality chance. But they haven't made any mistakes doing it yet.
Ball's on. Good shot. In fact, his coach, Tony Sarzan, says it's one of the hardest shots in the state. Malzahn, that's number two. Elk River bringing it back across the line and stopped right there. No, they're not. But Moorhead does intercept, and finally Ammerman clears his own.
And that's what Moorhead's got to do in his power play, is stand up more at the blue line. They were given the blue line a little too early in the first part of this penalty. Now they're standing up much better.
Long angling wide right, brings it into the zone, carries it all the way down in behind the goal. Still with it, hands it off now to number 12, Ostroot. Puts it out to the side, gets it back again. Ostroot cuts in front and fires a shot just wide. And it carries all the way back out to center. Penalty has expired. Loose back on the ice for Moorhead. And Elk River 0 for 1 in the power play tonight. Here's a steal. Turning is Griffer, and then his shot is just wide. Griffer giving chase on the far side, but Elk River will get there, pounding it off the boards. They'll take an icing call.
Well, Gifford was trying to get that puck over to Dietz right in front of the net, number 11. Unfortunately, he got him somewhat handcuffed, and it went right between his legs. It was a good opportunity there. Gifford made the right play, made it quickly. And that youngster, Gifford, by the way, Coach Osella's got 13 shoes, size 13. He's going to be a big boy, and he's a quality hockey player. Obviously, one of the better players around with those kind of statistics on an outstanding hockey player.
I bet they had to buy skates for him every year.
Oh, boy. I often wonder, you know, I remember Moose Vasquez, size 13s or so, and he wouldn't change skates. They used to hurt him too much when he had to break them in.
Here's Godlewski at his own blue line for Elk River. Pass tips off of a stick, so there'll be no icing. Tyler Johnson back behind his goal. Playing around the left side. Moorhead being a little bottled up now. Lee will send it back behind his net for Johnson. Going to the right side this time with the breakout. They slide it straight up the middle. And here comes Van de Velde leading the rush. Right up the slot, but it's pushed off his stick as he was converged on by four white-shirted Elks.
They came back and helped out. They made a real good play because it looked like a good play developing for Moorhead. But that back-checking wing for Elk River keeps coming back and helps those defensemen out.
Rogers to Godlewski. Long pass to center, but Moorhead throwing a check to cause a turnover and dumping it right back into the Elks' end. Rogers, fourth defenseman, likes to play in the small rinks. He's got good size. Fleetest of foot, says his coach. That's why he gets the smaller rink surfaces, and that's exactly what the XL Energy Center is. 85 wide by 200 long. Not too many high schools had the big Olympic sheets, which measure 100 feet wide, so there's a lot more ice to cover out there. Elk River dumping it in. It's a scoreless opening period. We're halfway through. The third quarterfinal game of the day here for the big schools, a Class AA bracket. Joe Emmerich back in his own end. Number seven for Moorhead. He's on a great 18, lost the puck. Picked up now by the Elk River, rather. Joe Long sending pass picked off back the other direction. Here comes Corey Johnson. Johnson on the backhand side, trying to play it out in front, but it's swept into the corner. He's encrunched into the boards, and the Elks start back. Big check thrown on along the wall by Moorhead. Looks like they're staying with the body just as much as the Elks are, Lou.
They are, and they have to, because they know if they don't take the man, eliminate him out of the play, they're going to give up some quality opportunities here. Moorhead's playing a complete game, but so is Elk River. Elk River's really doing a real good job of forechecking.
Conoran initiates the rush up ice. It's a long shot by Gifford right on, and the follow-up try by Oliver was blocked by the goalkeeper, Warhol. Elk still having trouble getting it out of their zone, and finally with the help of an errant pass going over top the glass, that brings a break in the action. Shots are 3-0 favoring Moorhead. There's no score.
Welcome back to the XL Energy Center in St. Paul. Elk River and Moorhead locked up in another classic. And it's amazing when you think about it. These are two schools that are nearly 3 hours apart. They've never scheduled each other in a regular season game, and yet this is a rivalry that is becoming one of the state's best. In fact, tonight is the seventh time that these teams have met in the postseason. Started way back in 1993 when they played here at the state tournament for third place. Moorhead won that one in double overtime. A couple of section finals in the mid-90s. Elk River finally turned the tide with a semifinal win in 96. And then has won each of the last two meetings here at State. So this, game seven, if you will, guys. Wally and Lou.
Game seven, indeed. And I remember that 2001 championship game, Lou. It was
That's
8-1 thumping that the Elks put on to Moorhead.
Well, we're not going to have that here tonight, I don't think, with either team, the way they're checking.
No. Elk River in the white, coming out of their own zone. Passes errant at center ice. Brian Lee picking it up. For Moorhead, shooting it right back to the Elks D. They spin it around into their own zone. However, first guy in is Nate Miller for Moorhead, trying to play it in front and not taking a chance. This junior goalie, Sam Warhol.
Well, that was a good play out of the corner and a good opportunity for Kluki there. But one thing you're noticing thus far, even though Elk River is working hard in their own zone and they're supporting one another, they're not efficient thus far getting out of the zone. They're not making good plays getting out. Whereas we've seen Moorhead under pressure, and the one thing Moorhead noticed real early, that Elk River was always forcing everything towards the boards, so they've started to come up the middle a little more, and they're making a little more defenseman-to-defenseman passes than back up the middle, rather than trying to force it up the boards, because Elk River's game plan is to force everything to the wall to try to jam it and steal it. That's the middle right there. That's,
yep,
that's
beautiful pass right up the middle. And here come the Spuds on the attack. It's loose down the left side. Centering it. It's right on goal. And off the stick of Warhol back to the sidewall. And the Elks immediately come roaring back. Long across the line, but his pass a little bit behind his target. It's an offside.
Speaking of Joey Long there, Wally, number 10, you're looking at him. He's been a big addition to the team. He had to miss a couple of games during the playoffs, came back for the final game, scored two goals. A big, big player for this Elk River hockey team. They certainly need him. They missed a young defenseman that left early during the year, and that's where they think they're having problems moving the puck out of their zone. Prosser left to go play junior, and he was their top defenseman moving that puck. And that's something that they lack, although this Godlewski is going to be a real good hockey player. He is a good hockey player already, one of the better young defensemen in the state.
Ostroot taking it in deep for Elk River, but it's broken up by Brian Gifford, the captain of Moorhead, who got it out to center ice. Elks off the sidewall. Pump it towards the blue line, but I think it went up into somebody's equipment.
I think Coach Dave Morinville, he knows Tony Sarzalin is going to have his team ready, and he expected that this would be this kind of game. Even though they had the scoring power we talked about at the top of the show, great balance, as you looked at Coach Dave Morinville, he knows that when you play in the Elk River team, and especially when you're playing a big game in these state championships, they come to play and they're going to work hard. One thing you're never going to get shortchanged with by these Elk River teams is work. They're going to work as hard as anybody.
Absolutely. They're a blue-collar team all the way. That's why Tony Sarzan likes to say, come to the practice rink with gravel in your pants. There's going to be some contact. And there's a lot of it going on behind the Elk River goal right now. But it's tit for tat so far. Neither Moorhead nor Elk River backing away from the physical play. He's going to be talking all night long to these guys. He might be doing more yelling down there than Tony Sarzan about keeping things going. And there's going to be a penalty coming up. It looked like a slash. And the referee, no, they're going to call it a high sticking penalty. I believe it's Moorhead getting the gate, or is it Elk River?
It's going to be Elk River.
It's going to be Elk River.
And it's going to give Moorhead the first opportunity with that 40% power play.
Yeah.
To get an opportunity to show it to us here tonight. They've had a great, great season on the power play. They need some opportunity here. Chris Johnson's going off for slashing. And now we'll see if they can crack that Elk River defense. It's been really solid thus far.
Elk River penalty kill on the other side of the coin has been 82.4%. Not bad, but not great. Across the line, Brian Gifford has a roll off of a stick. Giving chase, however, is Nick Dice. Elk River will get there first to clear. Moorhead's going to keep one guy back by the Elk River blue line to keep the pressure away. Meanwhile, Dites straight up the middle, angles left across the line. Now cut straight into the slot around one man, a back ender on goal, the rebound, and Warhol comes up with a pair of saves, sitting on his fanny.
Good move by Dites. He had a little move to get by the defenseman. He didn't have much to shoot at. He's on a short angle. He not only got the first shot away, the forehand got his own rebound. You see a nice little move here. But now he hasn't got much to shoot at. He gets the first shot, and then he comes up with the rebound, but Warhol played him perfectly. Goaltender didn't give him anything to shoot at and stayed on his feet.
Dites and Long on the draw. Elk River wins it, going back in behind their goal. Godlewski trying to clear as he's flattened. It does not come out, but Moorhead on the relay to the point. Miscue. Lee backing up, hands it over to Long. He lets a long wrister go on target, and that's the first shot on goal that has been launched. On goalkeeper, Derek Heidel. Through the middle, Dites. Across the line, slows up, then shoots, and that's batted away by Warhol to the corner. Moorhead trying to gain possession, but it's wrestled away by the Elks and flipped out to center by Longley.
That's right, it's wrestled away, and the Elks are winning all the battles along the boards in their own zone for that puck. And that's why they've been able to keep this game scoreless. They have been really good in their own zone getting control of that puck.
Brett Barta got it across the line, working in as Johnson, and it rolls just off the goalkeeper. Warhol inches wide of that left goal post. From the point, Lee's drive is off target. Back after it into the corner again is Corey Johnson, walking out of the left side, a give and go down low, and it just goes off the stick of Johnson. Lee stepping up from the point to keep the play in deep, but back in behind the goal is Godlewski, and he's able to flip it past the D.
Well, looked like a good opportunity for Moorhead, but one thing they did, they recovered well. The defenseman, Warhol, got a little help from his defenseman.
Well, the official screwed up here. Yeah. They called icing, and they're still shorthanded.
That's why they'll have the faceoff at center ice. Tony's laughing about it.
He's one of the most unique coaches of all time because look where he is. He's in front of the bench. Everybody else is behind. Who was a Russian coach that did that? Tikhanov?
Tikhanov.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was so odd to see that the first time. Remember the Russian broadcasters? They used to be broadcasting down on the bench right where the players. That's the only place they felt safe.
They were together. That's icing.
Yes, it is. We're going to take a break and get out of here for a moment. It's still a scoreless game, but Moorhead has outshot Elk River so far, 8-1.
You see the determined look of Long right there. The Elk River team playing with the passion, keeping his game scoreless over the highly touted Moorhead Spuds.
There's a shot attempt that's blocked. It's only a few attempts that Elk River's been able to manage. It took them 14 minutes into this game before Elk River got their first shot on goal. It was actually just a long clearing effort more than anything, Louie, while they were shorthanded.
That's right, Wally, but at the same time, even though Moorhead was getting shots, they weren't getting the real quality shots. They had maybe one real quality shot and two from the scoring area, but other than that, Moorhead has not been able to get real opportunities from the good scoring areas because Elk River is working very hard in their own zone and are supporting one another. They're always outmanning Moorhead deep in their own zone.
Trying to sprint up the middle to catch the loose puck was Corey Johnson. Couldn't, but now Brian Lee does carry on. Going in deep, working on the defenseman, Chris Johnson. Lee around the goal, glancing over his right shoulder, finds Hammerman at the point. The wrist shot blocked along the way. Now Graham picking it up. Hands it off to Long. Cross the line on the right, swept away by Hammerman. Long carries into the corner with it. Helping out is Brett Peterson going behind the net. Here's Petey, trying to play it out in front, but he's all tied up. Long swoops in for it. Passes to Peterson, pinched along the boards. He kicks it down low. They're looking for Long in front, but Ehrman blocks it. Peterson carries on for Elk River. Plays it back in behind the goal, but a little bit too far for Trent Graham. Shot back down low by Godlewski. Finally, Lee breaks out of a pack. Here he comes, down the left side. Across the attack line, but it swept away, and a good defensive play by Elk River to break up the effort.
And that's what Elk River has done all night long. And that play, that was Joe Long coming back to break up that play with Lee. But Elk River is recovering. They're getting back in the play. They have not stood around all night long. And one thing you have to do, here's where Long catches them. You have to keep moving. If you're going to play a good defensive game, you got to be under motion at all times. And that's why they really haven't given Moorhead very much, very good opportunities, even though Moorhead's had far and away better puck control.
Spuds behind their goal. Having trouble, they turn it over. Elk River beginning to amount some offense now. Connerin behind the goal, losing the puck. Ostrich tries to center, goes off the side of the goal, back to the point. A shot from there by Godlewski, ranges wide. Flipped off the glass by Oliver, but not out. Turnaround shot is blocked by the D in front for Moorhead, and as they poke it to center, the buzzer sounds, bringing closure to the first 17 minutes of play.
Well, the score reflects the play, 0-0, because there really weren't very many scoring opportunities there, and the checking ability of Elk River has really been the key factor in this period. Moorhead was moving the puck, Moorhead was moving with the puck, had more control of it, but they weren't getting chances because they were constantly under pressure from Elk River. And I got to believe right now that Tony Sarsland is feeling great about his Elk River effort. While at the same time, David might say he's happy, but Moorhead can't be too happy with the kind of period they had. They need better opportunities for that much puck control.
Well, Anthony LaPanta is downstairs, and he's with a guy who's been coaching for 30 years now, Tony Sarsland of Elk River.
All right, well, thanks very much, Wally. And Tony, a lot of years, a lot of teams to the tournament, and yet it seems like you always run into this team on the other bench. This is a pretty good rivalry for two teams that aren't in the same conference, don't schedule each other during the regular year.
Well, we've had a pretty good series over the years between the two clubs, and then anytime you play each other, you can throw out whatever the records of the two teams are. They have a pretty skilled team. You know, just comparing them to other Moorhead teams, this is not a knock in this year's team, but I wouldn't classify them as a great team, but they're a good team.
You got a pretty good period defensively, even though they got 8 shots on goal. Warhol made some nice saves for you. I thought your guys did a pretty good job coming back and neutralizing their scoring chances.
Most of the shots were from the perimeter. You know, they had a couple inside, but as long as you get them from the perimeter, that, you know, your goalie is playing fairly well, you should make those saves. We got to get it going down there. We've had the puck down there a number of times, but we're trying to cycle. We just want the puck to the net. You know, in a tournament like this, anything can go in. Just throw the puck on the net.
Thanks, Tony.
Yep, thank you.
Tony Sarsland, head man for Elk River. They're locked up in a good one with the Spuds. We'll be back. Jim Rich has our first intermission show next, live on Fox 9.
Welcome back to the XL Energy Center. No score between Moorhead and Elk River here in the quarterfinals. And these fans are excited to see some exciting hockey. But hey, check this out. Who could this be, Tommy?
Oh, wow. That looks like number 20. Phil Housley.
that was a guy about a buck 60. He's soaking wet.
look at the pants there, Phil. What happened?
Those Cooperalls.
We tried to break a new style of the state tournament. The Philadelphia Flyers followed suit that next year.
And then what? They just threw them out after that, or what?
No, I don't know.
they
recycled them, you know, the budget in South St. Paul.
You're wearing those in senior league now, aren't you? Yeah.
But what was that like, seriously, for you to come into this building and in that situation, the clear glass boards? I mean, we all enjoyed those days.
Oh, it was so exciting, especially in the old St. Paul Civic Center with 18,000 people. I got a little memory. We played our first game against Minneapolis Southwest as a sophomore, tied the score up at 45 seconds, got mauled by my teammates. I'll never forget that moment.
It was a great time, and we all remember those days when your teams were here. Let's take a look now what happened in this first period. And, Tommy, really, the Elks just didn't let the Spuds in.
Well, you know, Elk River did a great job playing defensive hockey. They back-check. You need to play good defensive hockey like that, but they need to get it into the other zone.
Well, I think that's what Elk River did. They came down, collapsed in their defensive zone. I think Moorhead's got to spread them out a little bit, get the puck back to the points, and get the shots through. There's too many shots being blocked, and they don't have any more offensive attack after that.
All right, let's look at the Chrysler stats in this period. And as you can see by the action that we showed you, that Moorhead had the big advantage, 8-1 in shots. The only shot for Elk River came 14 minutes into the period, shorthanded by Joe Long. They got to change that, Tommy.
Well, you know, you cannot play defense all night long and expect to put points in the board. So they've got to play some offensive zone entry here in the second period.
All right, we'll be back with the start of the second period right after this. No score between Elk River and Moorhead. Second period is coming your way next on Fox 9.
You're watching Fox 9.
Welcome back, everybody, to the XL Energy Center here in downtown St. Paul, the hockey palace of the nation in this beautiful building. And we've been here now for 4 years. Wonderful venue. And there was a state high school hockey history record that was set earlier today when over 19,000 people were on hand to watch the afternoon session of the quarterfinals today, an all-time high in the 60-year history of the state high school tournament here in Minnesota. So great to see that, but it's not sold out tonight, which is a bit of a surprise. Last year, over 115,000 people watched this tournament. And now to start our second period of a scoreless hockey game, there's going to be a minor penalty assessed. And I didn't quite catch who
it's going to be. Elk River for cross-checking. But one thing they don't want to do, they want to be physical, but you don't want to take too many penalties against Moorhead, especially when a team, you'll see it right here.
Oh, yeah.
Actually hitting from behind. And they're going to call it cross-checking so the kid doesn't get thrown out. But you don't want to take too many penalties against Moorhead. They have a terrific power play. They've been very successful all year long. And you only, you know, gamble so much. The Moss gets too close to that flame a few times, and you know he's dead.
Nick Knight's playing it into the zone, dropping it off for Ammerman, circling in the left side, plays it back to the point. Now to Ammerman, back to the left circle, rolls it down low, and sent it out in front, and camped right on the doorstep and not able to convert was Nolan Oliver.
That puck was moving around real well that time, and that's why you don't want to give him too many chances.
Really?
He missed a wide open net there.
Ammerman. Back to the right side, winding and firing. That shot goes off the glass, and that was a wicked bullet. Ammerman back down to the left corner for Deitz, puts it out in front. There's a shot. Oh, and a nice save there by the goalkeeper, Warhol. Oh, is Moorhead buzzing around the net. A couple of great tries by Brian Gifford, number 21. He gets the puck. Oh, and just about swept it home. Back it comes to the left point for Ammerman. Ammerman to Deitz. Back to the line. Gifford to Deitz, breaking to the net. Too far off target. Picked up by Elk River, but it's poke checked away. taken over now by Oliver. Trying to feed it in front for Deitz, but it doesn't go through. Oliver now trying to hand it off to Gifford. Doesn't go. They keep it in. Look at how quick the movement is. Centering pass. Block. Oh, the scramble. And Warhol down on his side a little bit early. But thankfully, the shot was low, and he was there.
Oh, that was a real good play. Ammerman that time made a perfect pass to Gifford. It just seemed to bounce off the blade of his stick. Had he been able to control that, by the time the goaltender could move across, he would have had an open net. And that's what the coaches are trying to do now, is make certain they're not getting outmanned like that. Two great chances right here. One across the net. Now watch this play right here. The pass going to Gifford. See, it just bounced off his stick. He fanned on it. The goalie was down. He would have had the upper part of the net. But this is real sharp, the way Moore has been moving this puck.
No kidding. Barta now launches a shot wide. Finally, Elk River slaps it, but not out. We'll try it again, but it's held into the blue line. Trying to cut in is Lee. He's tripped up. There'll be no call there as he maintains possession. Lee rolling it into the corner. Swept around a little bit too far for Matt Becker. Here's Becker, though, picking it up. Number 15, right up the gut. Oh, and a nice save by Warhol. And that was a shot from only 30 feet away. Here's Becker again. Nice move. He scores.
Oh, what a move.
Oh, beauty.
That was a beauty, Wally. You're right. What a move. He gave an inside fake, and he never broke stride. He was able to get right back to his forehand, beat Warhol on the goal stick side with a real quick shot. But you knew that was coming. They just had constant pressure there. Look at this play right here. Back to Becker. Little fake here. Right there. Enough to get free. Short side, beats the goalies moving across. And Becker missed one before, but he doesn't miss this one. And Moorhead moved the puck on that power play as well as anybody can move it. It never came out of the zone.
It didn't.
And how about the play by Lee, stopping it at the blue line with his skate? It looked like it was going out. It was on the wrong side of his stick, and he just stuck his foot out, kept the puck in there, and eventually it resulted in the goal.
Moorhead on a power play. In the power play, gets his 23rd goal of the year, giving the first goal of the game to the Moorhead Spuds. And here come the Spuds, breaking right up the middle once again. It's Miller going in, but he's forced wide as Elk River hurried back to negate the attack. It's the referees yelling, move your feet. Coaches like to use that line a lot as well. Malzahn working the left side. He's number two for Elk River in the white. Moorhead getting the puck again, cutting out in front. There's a shot, and it's blocked in traffic in front. Taking that drive with Van de Velde. Boy, he can initiate some offense, Van de Velde.
Yes, he can.
Just a junior. It's an all-junior line in which Becker's a right wing on it.
He's got some good size, too. He's a big kid, 6'1" centerman.
Elk River on their heels. They still have only one shot in this hockey game that came shorthanded. Moorhead has 12 on the board.
Well, when you get a goal and you get a lead like Moorhead did there, then you start feeling a little more freedom. You're not pressing as much. When you're in a 0-0 game, you're supposed to be ahead. All of a sudden, things get a little tight. You don't have the free-flowing actions that you normally do. When you're ahead like they are now, then you start opening it up even a bit more. You feel better with the puck. You make better plays.
Brian Lee hustling back in his own zone for Moorhead. Backhand to center. Picked up off the boards. Here they come on the attack one more time. Trying to roll towards the net is Gifford, but he's forced wide. Elk River will ring it around, but Nick Deitz gets over there. A little give and go down low with Oliver. Here is Oliver, number 23, working back up the side to Deitz. He banks it off to himself. He's got Oliver waiting in front, or Gifford rather, in front. Now he just taps it back in behind the Elk River goal. The Elks. Stick handling out of their own zone. That seems to be the successful way, at least in this period. Nice poke check there, breaking it up by Troy Johnson. Here they come down the right side. It's Oliver winding and firing a shot right into the gut of Sammy Warhol. Oh, we need a break, and I know the Elks do. 1-0, Moorhead leading on Becker's go-ahead goal. One shot for Elk River. They're having trouble getting out of their own zone. What's Moorhead doing so well in the forecheck?
Well, they're really getting on the puck here. They're supporting one another. It seems like they always got two men going down towards the puck. So they are really quick to get to the puck carrier, and they've also got help to eliminate him from the puck.
Moorhead playing it around the goal in their own zone. Ammerman passing across. Whoa, it bounces out in front, and there's a shot by Izzati just wide. They'll try it again. Ammerman around to the left side. Now they break it out. A nice tip pass. Good short passes. You don't see the long bombs by these guys. Here's Corey Luce centering it through the slot. Just wide, missing the stick of Corey Johnson. Stepping up is Brian Lee. Backhanding it behind the net, but it's turned over to Malzahn of the Elks. Again, two guys right on them. As Lou said, they're supporting each other so well. Backhanded by Luce over to the other side. The Elks finally deliver the puck to center. They'll wait for teammates to get onside, and it's lifted into the air by Conran. However, Johnson coming back now. We'll clear it all the way down for the Elks. No icing is going to be called, and here is number two, Nate Conran. Defensive defenseman initiates the rush up ice, broken up at the blue line, however, by 21 Chris Johnson, and the Elks get one of their rare charges across center ice. Shot attempt there by Trent Graham is way off target, and the Spuds back out to neutral. Off of a stick, Elk River trying to back in it. They do. Graham across the line, now to Long, working in a little bit off stride, and his shot's 5 feet wide. Holding the point is Kyle Rogers. But we do have a whistle and offside.
And looking at our goal scorer right there, number 15, Matt Becker. He's got a lot of tradition in his family, grandson of Willard Eichla. And he's got another young grandson playing over in Minnetonka, too. Joe Carter, I believe his name is. And just seems that Willard, even though he's out of the tournament, he's still got a little presence. Influence in it. He's a little presence here.
You think he wears that saber-tooth
hat? Oh, he does. I saw him at one of his grandson's games.
Yeah? Still got that, eh?
Hound's tooth hat.
He might have bought about 30 of them.
They're on special.
Yeah, where do they? You can't keep them that long, can you?
You got to wear out eventually.
There's a scramble going on in the Moorhead zone. Elk River trying to play it back for Dustin Longley. Falling is Godlewski. And here comes Moorhead, 3-on-2, getting the odd man attack going. It's Deitzer on the right side, but he's pinned into the boards and can't go any further. Gifford, however, comes in to help out. Relays the puck to the point. Whooped, it's fanned on. They'll just dump it back in and delay it offside, but everybody clears the zone, so we'll continue. Oh, look at the floater at center. Scatterelli going in with a shot, and a fine stop for Heidel. And a rare one indeed. Meanwhile, Moorhead sprinting back across the line. Corey Johnson is forced wide and can't go any further as Chris Johnson takes over for Elk River to clear the zone. Dumped right back in by the Spuds. Emmerich in behind the goal, pushed away by Malzahn. Elk River just chipping it off the glass to clear the zone. Johnson from center shooting right back in. A lot of Johnsons in this playoff this year. Here comes Chris Johnson for Elk River, 21, just bumping it in. Brian Lee back into the corner for Moorhead. Coming up the left side, a little pump pass off the wall is not out. A shot towards the net is blocked. And here's Lee getting it again. Over to Tyler Johnson. And not cleared. The shot, though, goes off the mesh up above the glass.
Well, even though they got forecheck there, one thing you'd notice on Moorhead's defensemen, they're moving the puck, they're moving it to each other, they're moving it quickly to the centerman. Just previous to that, you saw Elk River come out of their zone. Their defenseman had an opportunity for 80 feet to pass the puck. Yeah. He didn't pass it, so by the time he got over to the red line, everybody was stopped flat-footed. He had to throw it in, and Moorhead just picked up the puck, and they started coming out again. You got to move that puck to the open man. If somebody's open and he's ahead of you, give it to him. Give it to him.
Especially if they're moving, eh?
Yeah. The puck's going to travel a lot faster than you can skate.
Elks, Graham, behind the goal, dropping it off the left point, but it's picked off as it is partially fanned on by Peterson. Meanwhile, Moorhead back. Oh, deflected shot just misses. It was stopped out in front. And here come the Elks, surging straight up the middle. But good back-checking effort slows him down only momentarily. Here's Graham with a try. It's blocked. He gets it again. He scores. There was traffic in front. Graham went top shelf and over the left-handed glove of Derek Heidel and not up the game.
Boy, he was real quick to get his own rebound. He got the first shot away, and he pounced on that rebound. And as you said, Wally, the goalie was screened. He didn't even see it. Elk River, even though they only got four shots, capitalized on that and tie this game up. Some strong forechecking there. They get the puck, and here's Graham. One shot's blocked. Watch him just go right away, right to that loose puck, up in the upper corner. The goaltender being screened right in front by Peterson. And a good play by Trent Graham to tie this game up.
Well, I guess it sure doesn't matter what the shots are or anything else. It's a tie hockey game any way you cut it right now. Brett Peterson and Kyle Rogers will pick up the assists on that tying goal by the Elks.
This is exactly the kind of game that Tony Sarsland wanted for his team.
Elks back out of their own zone. Chris Johnson leading the rush, angling wide left, but it's poked check neatly off of his stick by Conoran. And moved back out to neutral.
Second assist to number 15.
Now Brian Lee for Moorhead. They're in the dark jerseys. Head manning a pass to Corey Lewis, who makes a wide sweeping turn, brings it across the line. Tried to get around the defense, couldn't. Third off to the side boards. Becker trying to get it there, but it's knocked away. And Lee will hustle back in his own zone, but with Elk River changing, he's got plenty of time.
One thing that Moorhead's doing, they're moving the puck out of their zone real well, but they are not moving the puck once they get over the offensive blue line. They're trying to individually beat men when they have people open that can get a shot or you know, open things up for them. You've got to move the puck. When you go 3-2, don't try and just beat the defenseman with it. Move the pass, make the defenseman move.
Play in the Elk River zone. Big check into the boards there. Pounded up along the wall for Moorhead was number 8, Chris Henry. Big scrum of players looking on.
And you notice Elk River's got 3 back there. They always have the extra man. A lot of support down deep for this hockey club.
Finally, the Elks get it out of there, but clear to the line and not out. Ammerman holding it in. Passes it down low now to Vandevelli, putting it on in front. The shot, and Warhol matches that with a brilliant glove save. 1-1's the score. Becker for Moorhead. Graham for Elk River. More hockey from the X.
Welcome back to the XL Energy Center. We're tied at 1 midway through the second period. We're joined by a special guest, Les Larson, who is the chairman of the Hobie Baker High School Character Award. It's a division of the Hobie Baker. Everybody's familiar with the Hobie Baker Award that goes to the top collegiate player. This goes to the best kid on his high school hockey team.
That's right, Anthony. One of the things that is an ingredient of our college award is not only do you have to be a great hockey player, but you've got to be an outstanding person as well. So what we decided to do this year, along with the High School Coaches Association, each coach picks the quote-unquote best kid on their team. Not necessarily the best player, but the kid that most exemplifies the values and characters of Hobie Baker.
And now this is just the start. Minnesota's just the start. You intend to broaden this nationwide next year.
Next year we're going to go national. I don't know if we'll do that in 1 year. There are approximately 35 states that have high school hockey and almost 40,000 kids playing varsity hockey across the country. So we hope to duplicate this award and recognize these great kids in other states.
Well, thanks very much, Les. Sounds like a great project of a sport that could use some sportsmanship right now.
Thank you, Anthony.
That's Les Larson. Let's go back upstairs to Wally and Lou.
Thanks very much, Anthony. And as a person who's been working on the Hobie Baker Award for the past 5 years, it is a great award and great to see it being extended a little bit deeper through the grassroots of the game as well as the collegiate level. Moorhead and Elk River in a 1-1 game. It's Elk River in the white coming up out of their own zone. It's Peterson across the line trying to give some chase into the corner, but the Elks, or rather the Spuds, are back. Then turn it over off of Ammerman's stick. They're still scrambling to get it up along the wall. Finally, it's grabbed off by number 12, Ostroot, playing it down low, just a little bit out of the reach of Scattarelli. And Moorhead jumps onto the attack immediately, bringing it across the line. 15, Becker, whoa! Now they still have control. Moorhead trying to stuff it in. Players knocked down wide of the goal hole. He would have had an easy tap in. And a close call there for the Elks in their own end.
Quite a passing play and a good opportunity. What a great save by Warhol there.
I love this line of Miller, Vandevelli, and Becker for Moorhead. Long pass is too far for Becker. It'll be icing instead, but they've generated a ton of offense. I know that Mike Cragness party up in Fridley, they like to play a little boot hockey, about 70 of them. They always put a little bet on who's going to get the first goal of the game, Louie.
Quite a pass there. This is one thing that Moorhead does very well. They move the puck down deep to the center. And that's why Elk River has been back there supporting one another, and they've really eliminated the majority of the opportunities that Moorhead's had thus far. But there was a good one there for Moorhead. They just couldn't capitalize on it. Elk River knows that Moorhead's going to be moving that puck down deep, and And they turned that puck up ice real good. Brian Lee started that rush, and that's how it all evolved, coming out of their own zone with speed, just like they're doing right now.
And it's an on-man rush unfolding, but Joe Long hustles back in the back-checking mode for Elk River. But meanwhile, carrying on is Kluge, checked into the end boards, trying to get in there to help out is Miller. Everybody move your feet. Let's do a line dance. It needs a little country western down there. Still banging away. We knew this was going to be a grinding type of game, and it certainly hasn't let us down from that aspect.
Well, the coach said what he was going to do for Elk River, and they're doing it right here. They are staying on the puck. They're checking. They know they don't have the offensive skills that Moorhead's got, but they know they can check.
Lee holding it in. He's number 22. He has the puck. Lee going in deep, trying to backhand in front, but Joe Long blocks that attempt. Now it's picked up by number 19, Zake. Jeremy Zake loses the puck, taken over once again by Kluge, relaying it to the point to try to thread it through. Doesn't go. There's a long pass. Whoa! And it just doesn't quite click, intended for Joe Long. Icing instead, and we're still tied at 1-1 here in the first of two quarterfinals tonight. Les Larson of the Hobie Baker Foundation just explaining the High School Character Award and a couple of captains of these two teams being rightfully honored, Nick Deitz and Dan Brody.
You know, the High School League.
By Volvo.
High School League's also starting the Herb Brooks Award, Character Award, that they're going to give out on Saturday night. One of these eight teams that are in here, one of their players will win that trophy on Saturday night.
Center ice, Moorhead flying into the attack zone. It's Nick Deitz, the Hobie candidate. Losing out, trying to get it through to Gifford, and back the other direction come the Elks. Center ice, number 16, Scattarelli. Trying to thread it through to Long. They can't. Moorhead breaking it up, but don't get it out. It's held in by the Elks, and finally Moorhead does bat it out to center. Shoveled right back in by the Elks. Elk River going for a line change. Moorhead with some time. A long pass goes deflecting into the zone. Racing in for it now is Nick Deitz. He's the second leading scorer in high school history. Actually, the second player in high school history in Moorhead to be in four state tournaments.
That's a pretty impressive statistic.
Oh,
we're going to get a penalty
yeah,
here to Moorhead.
We are. 23 in the dark, you heard. That's Nolan Oliver giving the Elk River player a good shot from behind.
They have no question about that call.
No, they don't. You can't do that.
No, they don't hesitate to call it either. That's the second one we've seen of those tonight. When you see a guy with his back to you like that, you shove him in the boards, they're going to call it cross-checking. And that's a play you don't want to see too often, because that's a dangerous play. But Elk River now tied 1-1, get an opportunity to take the lead here in the power play. They didn't look real sharp in their first power play.
No.
Neither did Moorhead, and Moorhead was a lot sharper in the second one. We'll see if Elk River gets as sharp as Moorhead did in their second power play.
Moorhead's penalty kill is over 91%, which is outstanding at any level of hockey. They also have 11 shorthanded goals, and they're trying to get their 12th here. However, they're warded off the play, and Elk River will initiate their power play from behind their goal. Long. Across the blue line. Gliding to the corner, breaks, feeds it back to the point now for Chris Johnson. Uh-oh. The shot blocked, look out. He'll recover in time.
You know, that was a good block, and you don't see many kids do that. Becker didn't leave his feet. He was down on one knee, blocked a shot, and that's what happens when you block a shot out by the blue line when you're down on one leg. The puck goes out front of you, and you got an opportunity for a breakaway. Not enough kids do that.
The simple things of the game that you have to learn.
In fact, not enough pros do that.
That's true.
They all think they got to leave their feet out by the blue line. They don't.
I can never understand that. Why do you want to leave your feet?
Yeah,
take yourself out.
Drives me nuts.
Did you used to do that?
No. I never leave my feet unless I was down by the net. When you're by the net and the goalie can't see it, then you fall to freeze it. You try and smother the shot.
And you still got all your teeth, eh?
And move quick.
Moorhead flipping it out of the zone with a 1:18 left to go in the period. See the power play time now ticking down to a half a minute. Elks trying to get one last attempt going, but an errant pass will allow Moorhead to swing it around, but not out. Longley holds it in along the boards. Longley down to the left corner is checked. Now gets it back again. 1 minute. Feeds it around the goal. A little bit too far, attempting for Joe Long, but he steps up. trying to feed it back over to Longley. Long and Longley. Now moving in is Scattarelli, number 16, in the white-shirted Elks. Pushed off a stick by Ammerman. Penalty has expired. Full strength situation again for Moorhead. They bring back everybody down low into their own zone. Ammerman rounds the goal, threads it up the middle. 33 seconds left in the period as they try to get one last rush going. Dykes tries to poke goalward, but it's deflected off to the side wall. Miller, number 24 for Moorhead in the black, had it, then lost it. Scattarelli trying to come up ice. Scattarelli kicking it up along the boards. Losing the puck, and it's thrown in by Moorhead. A dozen seconds remaining. Tip to center. Ammerman will have to wait for teammates to get onside, so he backs up a tad, and he'll just dump it in and probably settle for a 1-1 tie through two periods of play. And that is where we will be. So it's going to come down to one final period, Lou, in a tie hockey game.
That's right, and Wally, I would not want to settle for a 1-1 after two period if I was Dave Morinville. I would if I was Tony Sarsland. Yeah. I think right now, mentally, Elk River's got to feel better about themselves than Moorhead does. One thing I think Moorhead has not done as well as they can, they don't move it back to the point quick enough or often enough because they are getting outnumbered down low in the offensive zone. That's in Elk River's defensive zone. And it just seems that there's opportunities to get the puck back for shots. They're not doing it, and they could be much more effective opening things up like that if they would draw the puck back out high.
Well, let's find out what Dave Morinville, the head coach for Moorhead for the past 7 years, thinks about this second period of play. He's downstairs with our Anthony LaPenta.
Well, thanks very much, Wally. We're with Coach Dave Morinville. And Coach, a little bit of a frustrating couple periods for you because I think it feels like your team's playing better than a 1-1 tie.
Yeah, we're just, it's, you know, we've had some chances to score and we haven't buried it. And, you know, that makes pucks bouncing. And I don't know, I mean, obviously, I'm a perfectionist, so I think we could be playing a little bit better. But, you know, I think we've got to just play better when we have the puck. We're trying to panic it a little bit. And, I think they're a very underrated hockey team. And, you know, we've just got to take charge. And, you know, they're frustrating us, which is what their game plan is, that's for sure. So we just got to make sure we get shots on goal. I think we're trying to be maybe a little bit too cute. I think we could shoot more.
I think you hit it right on that this is more than just a team that can make you frustrated. They've got a little bit of skill. It's a very typical Moorhead Elk River game.
Yeah, it's a battle, you know, I mean, and Tony's a good coach. I mean, he knows that, and we've had good battles with him. So obviously now, hopefully our depth can come through in the third period, and that's what we're hoping for.
Anything you'll adjust here in the second intermission?
Well, like I said before, I think we're trying to be a little bit too cute. I think we got to just crash the net, go and get shots on goal and just crash that net instead of trying to be in tic-tac-toe too much and try to pass it around.
Thanks, good luck.
All right, thank you.
Dave Morinville, head coach for the Spuds. They're locked up in a good one, 1-1 after two. Jim Rich is next with our second intermission on Fox 9.
Back at the XL Energy Center in St. Paul, after one period, we were tied 0-0. Now after two, we're tied at a goal apiece. Jim Rich along with Tom Sagasaur and Phil Housley. And gentlemen, it was an interesting period and still, I think Elk River has to be happy with where they're at, as Louis said.
Well, junior goalie Sam Warhol played an excellent period. He was solid in the nets for them. But where they're lacking right now is they need shots on net. Right now they're down 3-1 in terms of ratio on shots on goal. Yep. They need to pick it up a little bit in that area.
Yeah, you looked at how Moorhead came out to start that period, Phil. They were unbelievable on that power play, finally cashing in. That's more of what they have to try to generate in the third.
Oh, definitely. You know, Elk River doesn't want to take any penalties, but I think Moorhead knows they're in a game now. Elk River's come out and played hard, but they got to be stopped, you know, make the good plays, the easy plays with puck support, get some shots on net, use the points like I talked about earlier, try to spread Elk River out and get the shots through. There's too many shots being blocked.
All right, let's take a look at the Old Dutch chip shots and some stats from the state tournament's past. Roseau, of course, has the state tournament record for games as they score, or goals rather, 267. Edina East, the best winning percentage in their short-lived history, 12-3. And John Mayasich, 7 hat tricks. That guy is Mr. High School Hockey.
I don't think I had 7 hat tricks in squirts, let alone in a tournament. So,
oh, it's amazing. And I know him personally, and he's just a great man. He is Minnesota hockey.
There's no doubt about it. Hope he's watching tonight and enjoying this one because it's a great one thus far. We're tied at 1 through 2 periods of play. Back with highlights and stats of period 2 right after this timeout. Back here at the XL Energy Center, and you see Sam Warhol outside his locker room listening to music, getting himself in the zone. He's been there already, only given up one goal thus far in this 1-1 deadlock. And you look at that shot, that's pretty interesting.
Well, I just hope it's not Barney music he's listening to. I hope it's something inspirational, because we need a big period out of him for Elk River to stay in this game.
I think with a haircut like that, I think you don't have to worry about Barney.
Well, I'm not sure what he's listening to, but hopefully it's something to make him inspire him. He's got to have a good period.
All right, let's take a look at the highlights of that second period. And Phil, as we talked about, that power play was sensational for Moorhead.
Oh, this is a great play by Corey Johnson. A little good give and go to Matt Becker, who is Willard Eichel's grandson. They bleed hockey in that family. It was just a great shot.
And you know, on the other side, watch Trent Graham here. He's going to come in. He's not only going to take the first shot, but he's going to get his second opportunity, and he's going to close it. Now watch him. He's going to set himself up. Boom, takes the first shot. He holds his ground. Second opportunity here, where many goals are scored in hockey. And there he does, makes the most of it, catches nothing but net in the upper right-hand side. Nice play by Trent Graham to even it up at 1-1.
And as we look at the Jeep statistics through two periods of play, shots are 15-5 in favor of Moorhead, but they haven't really been able to penetrate, get those good scoring opportunities that they need.
Well, Sam Warhol has done a great job. He's got to continue that. Elk River needs to help him out, play a little bit in the other zone as well.
All right, we'll be back with the start of the third period right after this. It's all tied at a goal apiece here at the X. Wally and Lou join us in just a moment.
Wally Shaver and Lou Nanny back here at the XL Energy Center for our third and final period of this quarterfinal contest. It's a 1-1 stalemate between Moorhead and Elk River. You gotta love Tony Sarzlin. You know, he has three words for his D, Louie: agile, mobile, and hostile.
And hostile, he means first.
Yeah. Not necessarily in any particular order. Here is Elk River. They're in the white jerseys, and they have come from behind to tie up this game. They've been outshot 15-5, as our downstairs crew pointed out in the intermission. But here's Moorhead on the attack. Dites across the line over to Oliver. And that shot is stopped by Warhol, who wears that Mohawk haircut.
Well, Tony was saying to us before the game, you know, we're going to really put a lot of pressure down deep on Moorhead. And if we do, we're obviously going to give up some two-on-ones. That's what they just did right there. But you know what? He's up at high school hockey. They don't complete 10% of the two-on-ones.
That's a good
point. And he's
point.
Right there, too.
Yes.
So, you know, they did do a completion there and had a shot from the side. But Tony's willing to gamble a little bit to try and get some offense going.
Graham, the lone goal scorer, is hauled down right in front of the ref, and no call. Well, here we go, back the other direction. Becker, the lone goal scorer, across the line, leaves a trailing pass for Johnson right in. Look out, there's a scramble at the side, and the net has come loose.
Well, Dave Morinville told his team he wants more shots, and we've seen that thus far. They're coming to the net and they're shooting the puck. That's what he wants to have them do, put some pressure on, but get some shots while you're doing it. They had been putting pressure on throughout this game, but they didn't get enough shots for all the pressure they've had. Here's the one that was no call, but you might say both of them had the opportunity there to pull each other down. Good opportunity there for Moorhead, though, and that's what they want to do. Corey Johnson again with that shot, but Moorhead made the save.
Spuds at center, pop up the puck. Trying to cross the line as long as he does, and try to center rather, and he couldn't quite get it through. Back the other way comes Nate Miller. Miller threaded through to a waiting Vandevelde, but it doesn't click. The other direction. Puck is controlled by Longley, but as he gets around center ice, it pops up into his own player bench and out of play. Two new shows premiere Friday night on Fox, Playing It Straight and Wonder Falls. Catch these new shows at the conclusion of Boys Hockey Friday night on Fox. Be a late one then for those premieres.
I was wondering what time they're going to be. I think we got off about midnight last night, buddy.
Yeah. Double A action tonight. These are the big schools in quarterfinal play. Earlier this afternoon, a couple of games that have been completed. We'll see Centennial and Wayzata advancing to semifinal games tomorrow night. One more yet to come this evening. And that will be a game featuring Lakeville in Duluth East.
Moorhead's been in the just near miss category all night long. Passes,
They were around the slot area for good shots. They just missed shots, just missed the net. They just quite aren't sharp thus far. They certainly are moving the puck the way they want to, but they're not quite sharp yet.
Dietz winds and fires, does deliver that one on goal, but it's Elk River picking it up off the boards. A attempted pass to Long rolls away from him. Now scooting up from his defense post is Brett Peterson, but he lost the puck at center. Dietz coming back now for Moorhead. There's a man on the left, Corey Lewis, but can't get it through. Still batting along the board. Four people crash there. Elk River trying to move it off, but Dietz will throw it back deeper into the zone. Elk River ringing it around, but stepping up is John Ammerman, the defenseman, trying to retreat and center at the same time, but it's blocked, and the Elk River Elks will just shoot it all the way down and take the icing call against them. Time now for our Volkswagen fan cam. We got lots of fans from both these clubs on hand, plus about 6,000 season ticket holders who just love to watch high school hockey at this time of year.
Elk River still doing a good job down deep in their own zone, especially along the boards. Moorhead's got to try and move that puck to the center area a lot more, where there's more room and they got an opportunity to get some shots. Everything seems to be forced to the walls in their own zone by Elk River, and that's what they want to do. Keep the puck out on the perimeter, because Moorhead hasn't been able to get quality shots with the puck always on the outside.
Scannarelli up along the boards. Pummeled into the wall there by number 19, Luce of Moorhead. Luce does get the puck free, trying to thread it through to Corey Johnson. Knocked away from him. What a battle on the perimeter of the rink this has been tonight. Stepping up and trying to clear back in behind the goal. Number 15, Matt Becker, cutting on in front. They score! Becker! 2-1 Moorhead.
Great play there, and that's what Moorhead has to do more of and hadn't been doing. Get the puck to the front of the net, not to the sides. That time, make no mistake about it, that was a great play by Corey Johnson and Becker, and they capitalized on a great opportunity right in front of Warhol, who had no chance on that one. As look at this play behind that, Becker fighting for the puck, picked up by Corey Johnson, centered to Becker, and he put it away right away. And that's what they weren't able to do up until this time. You didn't even have to flood the ice in front of the goaltender here tonight. All the play's been on the perimeter.
Big goal, and Becker with two tallies tonight, his 23rd of the year, followed up by his 24th to put Moorhead back up on top.
Well, now you might see more opportunity for Moorhead, and I'm going to say that because Tony's going to have his team gamble more. They're not a high-scoring team. You're going to see them pinch. You're going to see them get caught in two-and-ones and three-and-twos, trying to get an opportunity to score. And that'll give Moorhead some more opportunities himself to score if they're able to weather the storm. But watch the pressure that Elk River is going to try to put on forechecking.
Connor and turns it over. Elk River cutting in front. They score. The backhand shot by Brett Peterson ties it up. And a costly turnover by Moorhead defenseman Connoran.
And that's right. And that happened right down deep. Moorhead had the puck control right behind their net. But Elk River, three men deep. And that puck was turned over. Watch this play right here. Puck gets turned over right in the center of the ice, right in front of the net. Just a little backhander scored right there by Peterson as he steals the puck and ties his game right up. This has got to be real frustrating for Moorhead after they get a lead like that. They work so hard to get a lead. Right away, puck gets turned over and is back in the net.
Two goals in 21 seconds. A lone assist on that going to Trent Graham.
Scoring for Elk River.
And play comes right back into the Moorhead zone. The Spuds get it, tip it out on a nice touch pass. Here's Gifford breaking up the right side, going right in, and he fires it wide, but it was offside anyways. Whoa, two quick goals. And we're back into the same position we entered this period in, a tie game.
There's a cavity. I think he's enjoying it.
Your son, the dentist, loves that, eh?
Yep, my son Michael. All that get up.
Eat that cotton candy. You better get down there with some business cards, Lou.
Yeah.
Elk River behind their own goal. Malzahn trying to clear it out. Turning and reaching back is Corey Luce to keep it into the Elk River zone. Elks chip it off the glass to center ice. The puck is hanging there. Who's going to get it? Several people battling for it. Finally brought into the attack zone now by Graham. He's staggered, but tries to continue to carry on and cannot. Ammerman back up to the middle for Moorhead. Pushing it with one hand, a little bit too far for Matt Becker, who has two goals in this game tonight for Moorhead. It bounces in front. Oh, and Becker was wide open if it got through, but unfortunately it didn't for him. Now Moorhead will stir it up from their own blue line. The guy who played in that high school elite league in the fall, John Ammerman, shoots it down and goes off on a line change. Now, oh, look out in front of his own goal is Brett Peterson, who just tied it up, almost coughed it up there, and the Elks will take an icing call here to relieve the momentary lapse of reason.
Well, as the clock winds down, the puck becomes a hot potato for Moorhead, and Elk River has to feel a lot better. They want to get near the end of this game at least tied, because then anything can happen with one goal. Moorhead comes in with all that scoring power, and they're being held on the board to just two goals, and Elk River's got two themselves. That's right the way Elk River wanted to play this game.
Saw the graphic for our next game coming up. It'll be Duluth East, ranked number 7 in the state by Let's Play Hockey, against number 13 ranked Lakeville, who came out of Section 1. And that should be a fairly well-balanced game between those two teams. We're looking forward to that one. Complete quarterfinal play here at the State High School Hockey Tournament. We had the Class A schools going through their four quarterfinals yesterday, and it's the Class AA, the larger schools, with their quarterfinal action today. Already going on to semis is Centennial and Wayzata today. And we'll see what happens in this one with a tie game looking at us with just under 11 minutes to go. Here's Brian Lee with a shot that goes sailing wide of the Elk River goal. Moorhead continuing to apply the pressure. Dragging it out of there is Van de Velde. Dragging it over to Miller, who works the boards. Pinned up there by the Elks, who again send three guys down there to converge on the Moorhead spuds. Finally, as it's pried loose, Scattarelli will clear it to the line. It's not out. Bounces favorably to Elk River, and they just flip to center. Backing up for the spuds is Barta. Turning it over, he'll get it once more. Sends it down into the zone. Icing has been waved off. Having to hurry back is Trent Graham. Clearing it to the line. Deitz did not hold it in. And back we come on the offside.
One thing Moorhead's doing very well, they really are not giving Elk River any room in the neutral zone. They have a very small gap between their forwards and defensemen. And so Elk River never comes up through center ice with the puck and have a rush. By the way, when you look at that Brian Lee, this kid is going to be unbelievable.
Oh, is he?
I wish we had a camera on him the last shift he had. Just the smoothness with which he moved the puck and how he plays his position, how he faked the shot out there. This kid is one of the best kids that's been in this tournament. I mean, he is really going to be something.
He wears number 22 for Moorhead, wearing the black jerseys tonight. What's interesting about him, 9 goals and 37 assists as a defenseman this year in 26 games. Well, almost an assist and a half a game.
You're going to be pained to watch him play for a long time. Well, there's a penalty right
in front. Hammerman right in front of the ref. You're right, Lou. And he will be sitting down for the next 2 minutes, putting Elk River on the power play for just the second time tonight.
Well, an interference call, and this is something that Moorhead does not want. They're having trouble scoring. You get an interference call right there. Ammerman, I don't know how he thinks he was going to get away with that. You can't talk about that. Look, he's hooking him, trying to slow him down, and just pulled him down.
Yeah.
And Elk River hasn't had much opportunity at full strength. And so you got to wonder, when you give them an opportunity in a power play, they could put it away, and then you're having a difficult time scoring. Before you know it, you're out of the game.
Here's a chance for Long. He scores! Going top shelf, glove side, and Elk River gets their first lead of the hockey game.
Well,
that's a killer penalty.
That's what you worry about. You got 9:29 to go, and the team hasn't had many opportunities to score. When they had one or two, they scored, and all of a sudden you give them a chance on the power play, and they had 29% this year. And a guy that's been doing it all night long, who's been definitely the best player out there for Elk River, is Long, and he does it right here. A great shot up high, right under the pipe, right off the faceoff. And Elk River's been winning the majority of the faceoff here tonight, too.
And that was Graham winning that one, and it only took 5 seconds because of Graham's ability to win the faceoff and leave it for Long. Here comes Elk River. Hair flying off of Longley as he plays it in deep. Back into the corner goes Longley, number 8, waiting patiently off to the side as the other two players pin it along the boards. Longley was knocked down and bounces back up. Now getting in to help out. He backhands it up the side wall, but it doesn't go back to the D, and they'll have to chase it all the way back into their own zone with Scattarelli going back for it. Big check thrown in behind the net by Moorhead. They turn it over, comes back to the point. Stepping up is Barta with a blast. It's off the glass. Left side, Harriman can't get to it, and Elk River coming out of their zone. They got a man open. There's a pass at the right. There's a wicked shot by Ostrew, and it's wide. Hammerman leaving it in the corner. Moorhead's Barta has it, stops, backs up a couple of steps, and then feeds it ahead now for Henry. His pass across the line on the stick of Vandavelli, who centers it. Oh, what a great effort by Miller to put it on goal, but he was hauled down in the process, and Elk River will be penalized. Wow, this is getting interesting. It's a 3-2 hockey game, but we're going to come back with a Moorhead power play.
Graham got the penalty, Wally, but that was a good penalty. And by the way, Warhol had to make a terrific save because Miller still got his stick on it, was able to deflect it on the net.
Becker in front of the goal, just missed. Brian Lee with a backhand, a look out, Long makes the save at the side of the net before he's knocked down. Lee continuing to stick handle in. Look at this kid. He's the one we're talking about. Plays it behind the goal in front, now for Becker. Oh,
he scores! No, he
hit the crossbar. Play continues. There's a shot that's blocked out in front. Red light came on, but the referee waved it off. Still going in the power play. There's a shot by Becker that carries off to the side wall. Vandavelli after it. Now to Becker. In front. Goes to the backhand. Drops it off for Barta. Back into Becker. Cutting in front, and his backhander's off target. Digging it out of the corner now is Johnson. Trying to cut out in front, but he turns the puck over. Godlewski will try to clear. It bounces and finally escapes the zone. We'll have a replay. Stay with us. Here's Lee across the line. Lost the puck. Moorhead regrouping at center. Dice checked on a nice jolt as he stood up and open ice by Chris Johnson. Turning it down low is Becker. Got to be tired near the end of his shift. Dice getting the loose puck. Going to the left side with a pass. Now across to the other point for Lee. Back out in front for Dice. The shot is blocked. Puck loose. Dice picking it up in the right corner now. Nick Dice rolling it off for number 23, Nolan Oliver. They find Lee at the point. The wrister. He scores!
What a goal by Lee. He was smart enough to just wrist it. He didn't take any time. I think Warhol was a little screened, but I have to tell you, that was a well-deserved goal because they really had some opportunities. Again, they moved it around tremendously well. And previous to that, the referee was in perfect position. I think that did hit the pipe. He made the right call. But Moorhead never quit. They kept the pressure on, they tied the game, and that kid, this Lee, is unbelievable.
Isn't he?
He is unbelievable.
And he's just a junior.
Look at this, he just wrist shot. He knows he's got to get away quick. And look at the difference. The goalie saw part of it, it hit part of him, went in the net. But here's the key. See how quick he gets rid of the shot?
Yeah.
Too many defensemen in the tournament today and yesterday, we've been watching them have their shots blocked. They took too long to get it away. Not this guy, he risked it, and he made sure he got it on net.
That's why he's one of the leading scoring defensemen in the state. Brian Lee. Remember that name, folks. He does everything well, is what his coach says when I asked him what his strengths were. Well, here's a steal at center ice. Godlewski will shoot it in. The only assist on that goal will go to Nolan Oliver as they were changing their power play unit halfway through that manpower advantage. It is a power play goal, and we're tied at 3-3. Shots, though, tremendous advantage for Moorhead, 24-7 in this game. Doesn't mean squat. They're both putting them home. And it's a tie game. And breaking out of his own end is Brett Barta. Slow down at center. However, they carry on, but jolted as Nate Miller as he dumps it in deep. Elk River rings it around. Nobody there. Stepping up is Tyler Johnson with a shot towards the net. Blocked and finally whistled out to center ice by Cole Scattarelli. Whoa, there's a turnover. Another shot right on by Ostrew. Big save. Ostrew behind the goal, trying to cut out in front. Heidel stopping it. He's down on his knees. The puck is loose. And finally stalled as there's a convergence of eight players down in the goal mouth.
And one thing you got to be very careful of there, that the goaltender freezes the puck, not a forward or defenseman, right. Because then it's a penalty shot. And I'll tell you, the referee was looking at it. He was right in the back of the net, making certain that the goalie was the one that had that thing covered up. For a moment there, it looked like the players were going to try and freeze that. Watch the puck here. It's loose. Now everybody sees it. Now they're trying to jump on the puck. When you jump on it, what you do is you push that into the goalie's pad or into his glove, but you don't push it into the net, and you don't hold it.
And you don't push the goalie.
That's right.
Okay, it's still 3-3. Boy, what a barn burner of a finish we got here at the high school tournament tonight. Long, across the line for Elk River. Unloads, it's blocked. Moorhead spinning it around the goal. It's blocked one more time. Here's Graham picking up. He's dangerous. He centers it. Kicked out by a falling goalkeeper, Heidel. Now back comes Johnson. Corey Johnson centers it. Becker tied up, but still gets a shot away. But it's right into the elk on the sweater of netminder Warhol.
That's right. What an effort by Becker. He was tied up. He was completely tied up. He had the presence of mind to keep his stick on the ice and get the shot. Here's an earlier chance by Elk River, and watch the goaltender. He tries to deflect that puck when he's reaching over. He was lucky he was able to kick it out. But here's Becker being checked. He gets his stick on the puck, gets it up, but Warhol played it perfectly.
3-3 hockey game, under 5 minutes remaining here in the third period. Godlewski started the right side, cut to the middle, passes up the right wing boards. Elk River launching a long shot, high and wide of the Moorhead goal. Peckers back inside the line, and Godlewski will tag it down again. And their best defenseman, he's a good all-around guy back there.
And he's having a great night here tonight.
Now he's got a one-on-one, but a backhand shot there goes wide off the stick of Gifford. A dangerous score for Moorhead. Out to center, goes the pass off the boards. Colin Ostroot will send it in deep. Taking a look over his right shoulder is Brett Barta. Heading in the puck now for Oliver. Oliver gets away from one guy. Oliver going down the left. Goes in behind the net. There's a trailing pass. Nobody there except Chris Johnson of Elk River. He'll just flip to center and go off on a line change.
Oliver should have really driven right to the net. You know, rather than make the move. When you got just a step on the guy,
yeah, he hit it.
You might as well drive right to the net, try and just get something on the net and crash the net, hope for a rebound or something, but get an opportunity, get a shot.
Godlewski down into the corner. Graham trying to dance out of there, was tied up, stripped of the puck, and the guy who did it is Van de Velde, lugging it to center, handing it to Brian Lee. He's got the tying goal. Lee's clearing effort is blocked just inside the line by Malzahn. Now he's pinned up along the boards. Four players converging, pried out of there by Van de Velde, cutting right out in front. Whoa, and his shot goes off the goalie and just wide to the left. Here comes Joe Long screaming back, trying to get around the D. Angles wide right, stops, looking, feeds it across to the right for Malzahn. His shot bounces, and just wide of Graham waiting at the side. Elk River player falls. That was Dustin Longley. Moorhead back in behind their goal. Soft pass going over to Emmerich. Streaming up the right wing boards. Picks up a first, hits center, just lobs it in. Moorhead changing on the move. Elks back in their own end. Pass tipped out to neutral ice by Ostroot. The D taking over for Moorhead. That center's Barta. Dancing across the line. Stick handling deep into the corner. Upended and losing possession. Here comes Elk River. 3-3 game. Headman pass. Sprinting after it, Ostroot. Checked off the play, but continues forward. Then lost it. But so did number 15, Becker. Lots of checking going on. Puck taken now by Peterson. Behind the goal. Here's Peterson, 18 in the white for Elk River. Trying to thread it through to awaiting Ostroot, but can't, and the Moorhead Spuds will have the puck. Here come the Spuds. Corey Johnson down the right. Centers it for Becker. He snaps it, but it bounces over top the goal. Netminder Warhol sticking it off into the corner, reaching for it as Ostroot, but he can't clear. Brian Lee will hold it in. Elks then do find time to get it out to neutral. Changing on the goal is Moorhead. Winding up his dice, a shot is wide, but gloved by Warhol, who holds. Buck and a half to go, folks. It's a tie hockey game. Next goal wins.
A
Our Dodge game summary looks like this. Defenseman Brian Lee with a tying goal. Big guy Becker, though, has chipped in two of his own. And Graham for Elk River has a three-point night going, and he would love a fourth.
And what's not chewing on there is how effective Joey Long has been for Elk River.
Dykes bursting to the net right off the face, off the puck, loose, a shot by Gifford is blocked by traffic in front.
I think that shot hit his teammate.
Tyler Johnson back at center after Dykes, who just tips it in deep. Godlewski checked into the wall by Dykes. Two more come in. Dykes chasing it down behind the net, but Elk River gets there first. Winning that battle was Joe Long. Pass is blocked. Godlewski had it knocked away from him by Gifford. Now they go around the other side this time. It's still bounding around.
Long,
as we end the final minute, has a pass blocked at center ice. Oliver reaching back. Goes into his D with it. Hammerman will send it down, and it's tipped into the zone, so there'll be no icing. Moorhead's guys are tired going off. The first line of Oliver, Gifford, and Dykes have logged a lot of ice tonight. And at center, here's Vandevelde with a big sweeping turn to the left boards. But he's stopped in his tracks by Chris Johnson, who relays it. Out, but not out. Here's a shot. And it's wide. Moorhead continuing after it. From the point. Look out. That one bounces off of a player in front. Chris Johnson to the sidewall. Becker is alone in front, but the pass just out of his reach. Hustling back to center ice is Ehrman to gain control. Pushing it out to neutral. Godlewski stops it there. And as he sends it in, it's off of a leg, so no icing. With 6 seconds to go, one last gasp for Elk River. We'll have to wait on a delayed offside. It ain't gonna work. Guess what, Lou? Overtime.
Not only overtime, I'm afraid this is going to be a late night. We're not seeing a lot of chances by Elk River, but if they get an opportunity, they seem to be able to put it away. We've seen a number of chances this period by Moorhead especially, and Warhol has played a terrific game in the net for Elk River.
Well, Moorhead, the head coach for Moorhead's got to be worried. He's got a better team. They've really outshot them 27-9, but they're looking at a tie contest.
That's right, and obviously he's worried because, you know, it only takes one goal now, the game's over. One thing Moorhead's doing, though, they're trying to force too many pucks into the area right in front of the goaltender. They're not spreading out in the neutral zone, in the offensive zone. They got to keep somebody maybe 15, 20 feet high, not right on top of the goaltender. They can't get any pucks there. You know that Elk River is going to support themselves, their team down low. They've got as many as four guys down there many, many times. So that leaves a lot of open ice up higher, and they're not using, Moorhead's not using that part of the ice.
All right, we'll be back for overtime and see who will advance to tomorrow night's semifinals.
Welcome back to the Xcel Energy Center in downtown St. Paul. This one's headed overtime. The winner advances to Friday's semifinals. One man who's already advanced is Centennial head coach Eric Oss. Eric, congratulations on the win today. What a performance by your goaltender, Greg Stutz.
Yeah, Greg really came to the forefront, and I've been telling people all year long is that Greg doesn't get the accolades he deserves, and he showed today what kind of goalkeeper he can be in shutting out Holy Angels.
And your go-to guy made the big play to get you the goal you needed.
Yeah, Tommy made a nice burst, nice power move out of the corner and went five hole. Yeah, it was nice to see.
You've seen both of these teams. Does this surprise you at all to see them headed into overtime?
Well, Elk River does a great job of bending and never breaking. They just make things so difficult for you in your offensive zone and their defensive zone. I'm surprised that Moorhead gave up three goals and only nine shots, but, you know, Elk River just frustrates people, and they buy into Tony's system, and they're doing a great job.
Eric, good luck Friday night.
Thank you, Anthony.
That's Centennial head coach Eric Oss. They're already there. One of these teams tries to join them, and I know Wally and Louie have been praying for overtime all afternoon. You got it, guys.
Well, thanks a lot, pal.
I think interesting comments, though, by Oss about how he observes these two teams, eh?
That's right. That's exactly what's happening. Elk River, you know, you think you're going to get something on them, but they work so hard defensively in their own zone. You think you got chances. They don't give you much freedom.
8 minute overtime. And we're underway. Puck comes into the Elk River zone. Picked up by the Spuds. They come out in front. Oliver with a backhand pry off the glass. Look out. It almost bounced out in front. Losing his stick as the defenseman mauls on. He's just trying to tie it up. Elks will send it up the center. Oh, big check thrown. Head down by Ostrud. He paid for that one. Back across the line. Here comes Brian Lee. He drops it off for Dice. Centers it. Oh, point blank range by Oliver. And what a save by the goalkeeper, Sam Warhol.
That's a save of the game. That was a 10 baller.
Center ice. The Elks trying to get it going themselves. Here's Peterson across the line. Forced off the play by Lee. Rounding the Moorhead goal now is Brian Gifford up to Becker. He's got two goals. Here's Becker trying to cut in. He does. He centers it all, and it just misses Gifford. Look at Becker. He picks it up on the far side. Converged on by three. Sends it down low. Rustling up along the boards with it is Corey Luce, number 19, but he can't quite get there. And here comes Captain Joe Long, number 10 for Elk River. Long. Cross the line. Look at him go. Backhander right on. And goalkeeper Heidel is down to cover up.
Long is the most dangerous forward out there tonight for Elk River. Dangerous again. Made some good moves. Came to the short side. But the goaltender Heidel played him perfectly on that side and certainly made the save and covered up. But what a chance right here. What a 10-bell save. That was a beautiful pass right across. Moorhead having a great opportunity. They had great puck control in the offensive zone. They had a couple chances, but that one was the best chance of all.
Here's our ace. Kluke after it. Cuts to the middle. Chris Johnson picks it up. Johnson's centering pass, though, is blocked by a sprawling Godlewski, number 14 for Elk River. Up behind the net. Kluke getting it again. Kluke now handing it off. There's a shot from the point. Hits traffic in front. Ammerman, another blast. Blocked the rebound. They score! Moorhead wins as Luce backhands it home.
And what a good play by Luce. He's being checked, and he was able to get this backhand on that puck and put it past the goaltender. The key was the defenseman getting the shot through on the second time. The first one was blocked. The second time, he made no mistake about it. He got the shot through, and Moorhead had worked so hard but just didn't seem able to beat Elk River for three periods, was able to do it in the overtime after tremendous pressure from the outset. A lot of pressure, and there's the guy, Corey Luce. Yeah. He gets the biggest goal of the evening.
The biggest goal of his life.
Yeah, a wonderful backhand. I mean, I'll tell you, he had to fight off a check, get the shot. Here you see the shot from the point. The first shot gets blocked, comes right back to the point, man. This time he gets it through. Ackerman, Ammerman, and he gets it through, and Luce got the backhand past the goaltender.
Minnesota Forest Industries play of the game. Boy, did he get a hold of that, too. He stepped right into that shot.
Luce from Ammerman and 143.
And what a solid game we saw from that goalkeeper for Elk River, Luce, Sam Warhol.
Boy, he played well tonight.
Yeah, he did.
He really played well. 29 shots on net, and it took overtime to beat him. But Moorhead was the better team during the match.
Yes, they were. They had 29 shots to Elk River's 10.
You got to say that Coach Sarsland had his team playing exactly the way they had to play to make it a game. And they, Elk River's got to be proud of the way they played, how hard they played, because this Moorhead is a quality hockey club. I think you're going to see Moorhead play a great game tomorrow night. I think this was a big game for them, because as we were talking about earlier, quite a rivalry between these two teams. And it's in the mind, you know, Elk River has beaten them here in the state tournament pretty badly the last time. And in their mind, you got to get by that. Even though some of these kids weren't there, this was something that they had to get by. And I think you're going to see them play a terrific game tomorrow night.
Three-game winning streak for Elk River over Moorhead has ended as the Spuds win it in overtime to advance to the semifinals. One more quarterfinal match coming up next.
Back here at the XL Energy Center in downtown St. Paul, and what a thriller we had here. Moorhead knocks off Elk River 4-3 in overtime. Jim Rich along with Tom Sagasore and Phil Housley. And gentlemen, what a hockey game that was. In that third period, when these teams get the chance to shoot, they bury it.
Well, that third period was just a great hockey game. Andy Warhol, I mean Sam Warhol, actually played just great. He was absolutely super. Without him in the nets tonight, it could have been a different story.
Yeah, Moorhead, they didn't get rattled, Phil. They gave up two goals on two shots, but they kept their composure, came back to tie, and then get the winner in OT.
Well, I'm not going to say I said it, but I said get those shots through. And Brian Lee gets one, doesn't have to be hard. And the real hero is Ammerman. He gets his first shot, follows through with the second shot, gets it through. Luce pounces on the rebound, and the game's over.
Speaking of heroes, let's take a look at the Super America superheroes of this game. And it was a tough time picking players, but Mac Becker of Moorhead, he did a great job. Two goals and a crossbar in that third period.
Oh, he had an excellent game, and I think Corey Johnson also had a great game. He found Matt Becker twice and resulted in goals.
And so there we go. It's done. Moorhead wins it 4-3 over Elk River. They advance to the semifinals. Coming up next, a Fox 9 news break, and then it'll be quarterfinal number 4, all here on Fox 9.